Hi. Hello, YouTube. I hope everyone can hear me and see the slides. This is actually the first time I think we're doing something like this digitally over YouTube Live. So please bear with us if something should not work around the first time. Yeah, welcome to this presentation about Kodi V19, Codename Matrix, and beyond on the occasion of the remote Keras experience. To those of you that might not know, Kodi is an open source media center application that is available for many operating systems and hardware with a UI that is suitable for usage on televisions and remote controls. And the remote Keras experience, RC3, is a virtual replacement for the Keras Communication Congress that takes place annually in Leipzig, Germany. Not this year, unfortunately, of course, and now is the last day of the RC3. And we at Kodi thought that on this occasion, we would like to give you an update on what's happening with Kodi, the release of V19, Codename Matrix, the changes that will happen in 2021, and the ideas we already have for V20 and after that. And finally, we will also have a Q&A session about everything Kodi. To round up the presentation. My name is Joel. I'm a Team Kodi member since 2017, working on Linux development and also a Kodi Foundation board member since this year. I'll now cut off my video so you can see all the slides. So first of all, about the Q&A session. There is a link in the YouTube video description, or you can also scan this QR code or go to pigeonhole.at in your browser and enter the passcode CodyRC3, as you see on the screen. There you will be also able to ask questions yourself and vote on questions that other people have asked that you want an answer to at the end of the presentation. Please note that any piracy-related questions will be deleted and not answered. Okay, to start off with Kodi V19, I'll now show you a nice intro video that our resident artist Sam Fischer has created for us. And you can enjoy for half a minute. Okay, thanks for watching that. As you could probably guess, the key code name and the format is Matrix, because we like to name all Kodi releases after well-known movies or TV shows or characters. And we have a community poll for every release. So this one is Matrix, the last one was Leia V18, and the next one is not yet determined. So V19 development has started in 2019 with the release of the last version, 18 Leia, and it's not here just yet. It's been a longer ride than usual and than many of us would like, maybe. We have been in pre-release development up until August this year, then started doing 3 alpha and 2 beta releases, which finished up this month. And in early January, we will release the first release candidate of Kodi V19, and then we will see how it goes, how many bugs there remain, and if everything is well with the release candidate, we will have the final release in early 2021. For Kodi Leia, 18.9 is the final version. There will be no more updates to Leia. And if you happen to be on an Android device, you can actually select the Kodi application beta channel in the Play Store right now and get started with trying out version 19, the latest beta. And then in January, the release candidate will also be uploaded to the beta channel. So why has this taken longer than usual? We mostly had an annual release before that. There are a number of reasons, of course, but I think the time might have been needed also for the Kodi ecosystem to move along as well as it did now, because there's one really major change that will impact a lot of users, which is the migration to Python 3. Add-ons known to, I think, any Kodi user are really key to the Kodi experience. Because there's lots of integrations that you can have with metadata for your video library, with video streams, audio streams. For example, there's a plugin for media.ccc.de, which you could use to watch the RC3 streams in Kodi, and also add-on for YouTube and other streaming providers, and so on and so on. So Kodi would really not be what it is today without all the add-ons. And this system still runs on Python, which is a programming language in which these add-ons are written in version 2.x, which was declared end of life by the Python community at the beginning of this year, actually. So it's already end of life for a year now. And this means that there are no security updates anymore, that the whole Python package ecosystem is moving to Python 3, the next version, and Linux distributions, for example, have begun phasing it out of their repositories. So we don't really have a choice. We need to move from Python 2 to 3, and Kodi v19 will finally do just that. This was originally started as a Google Summer of Code project in 2017, and now was finally finalized and merged for Matrix. And we are now targeting Python version 3.5 as a minimum, and working up until, I think, the latest Python version. Unfortunately, add-ons that were written for Python 2 don't just work with Python 3, because the language, the programming language itself, has changed a bit. So add-on authors and maintainers are forced to update and make changes to their add-ons to make them compatible with Python 3. Many of the add-ons are already compatible. You can have a good experience on Kodi v19, the release candidates and the betas, with many add-ons already there. But there are some add-ons, or many add-ons actually, that are not really maintained anymore, that were written by the author some years ago and then not really updated. And of course, those will cease to work in Kodi Matrix, as only the add-on author can make any updates of that. On the bright side of this, this also means that in our official repository, there will be a lot less old add-on craft that is not working anyway anymore, for example, because it was depending on some internet service that is not available anymore. We are really making quite a fresh start with the repository, so to speak. And we expect this to be a somewhat bumpy ride for most users. So you will definitely want to evaluate v19 first before switching for good, to see if all the add-ons that you love to use are available and work correctly. Actually, if you start v19 for the first time, you will notice that all your add-ons will continue to be installed. But there will be a forced update and migration on the first run. So make sure you have a stable internet connection when you do that. And any add-ons that do not have a compatible version for Matrix will be disabled until the time that an update might be available. Of course, this is not the only change. This slide lists some of the other major improvements and features that are coming to Kodi Matrix. One really cool thing that I like is Python-based metadata scrapers. Metadata scrapers are the programs or rules that extract the information about, for example, music and TV shows that you have in your library from online services like IMDb or the MovieDB. And previously, those were based on an XML description language that put the rules for parsing this metadata from the web pages into an XML document. And this unfortunately turned out to be a bit error prone and very, very difficult to maintain and understand. And with the Python-based scrapers, they will now just be any other Python add-on, and you can write that in a normal Python code. Then furthermore, Kodi will come to the Apple TV, the tvOS platform. It supports the top shelf and the Siri remote and the Apple 4 and the 4K devices. But you need to be aware that just as the Kodi version for iPhone, it is not in the official App Store. You will have to find some way to put it on your device, such as sideloading. add-on repository. The next point is means that add-ons from the official Kodi repository cannot be overridden by third-party repositories anymore, which was a great cause for user crashes and bad experiences that we have identified, because often those were not compatible with other add-ons. So now you can be sure that the official version in the repository will be preferred. We have some high dynamic range support depending on the platform. For example, on Windows and Android, we have HDR10. On Android, with more streaming providers, and if your device can do it, you should also get Dolby Vision HDR. And on Linux, with the GBM, Generic Buffer Management API, which is the low-level interface that Kodi can use to talk to your graphics hardware, you should also get hybrid log gamma and PQ HDR, depending on your device and drivers. It's really quite on Linux, it's quite a cutting edge stuff, so there's still a lot of rough edges around that. There are also many improvements to the PVR platform, too many to list in detail. You can find all of this on our official website, kodi.tv. We have software AV1 decoding support. AV1, some of you might have heard of it, is a new codec developed by the Alliance for Open Media that might become a really standard video codec in the next over the next few years. It's backed by a few large companies and completely free of patents and royalties. So we hope that AV1 will continue to thrive, and that there will be hardware decoding support for that also. And on the GBM platform that I also already mentioned, on Linux, we now have better support for embedded devices like ARM devices with zero-copy software decoding and stateless hardware decoding support with the Video for Linux 2 platform, which is the quite recent and new hardware video decoding API on Linux. And this should mean that you can expect better performance from software decoding and hardware decoding the like on ARM devices with official Linux drivers. Going on to what we want to do in version 20 and beyond that, as always, nothing of this is guaranteed. We have no strict roadmap, and Kodi releases are mostly it's to be released when it's done. And this is more of an idea pool of things that we think are cool and we would like to happen. We would like to have sandboxing for binary add-ons, such as PVR add-ons, because right now, if they crash the whole application, which is not very nice. We want to improve tagging and searching of add-ons somewhat in the user interface of Kodi and also on the website. We've actually had two successful Summer of Code students this year again. And they have one of them has rewritten the default Chorus 2 web interface with the Yelm language, and the other has written a save state manager for RetroPlayer, which is the retro gaming platform built into Kodi. And both of those are really cool projects. They were successful, but the code still needs some finishing and polish. So we hope that this can get merged soon in 2021. Then a quite major point is that we want to have rendering with Vulkan, which is a graphics API like DirectX or OpenGL or GLES. But unlike DirectX or GL, it really supports all of the platforms, even Apple, with a translation layer. So we are thinking that in the future, this will become more and more important. And we already have a proof of concept running with Vulkan, done by a very enthusiastic team member. So I'm really looking forward to that. We want to continue our efforts to make Kodi run headless, which means without a news interface. So right now, you could not run Kodi on like a terminal server or something like that without any user interface at all. Because the software is just not designed to do that. There's really great entanglement between the application logic, the video rendering, and the user interface. So it's just not possible at the moment. But it would be a cool use case to support. For example, you have it at a media server in your home, and then you can access it via UPnP or via the web interface. So this is a path that is going on now for some years, and that we want to continue. Other ideas are signing of add-ons by the authors, further continuing the HDR support on Linux with Intel and AMD hardware, which I think is also still being integrated on the Linux kernel side. Then there's the topic of web browser integration with Chromium now, which is in the works for some months and I think years even, that we might to see come to life in 2021. And finally, we want to make use of modern C++ features, because some things in the Kodi code base are quite dated, and we want to replace the custom code with new standard library equivalents. The infrastructure changes that I've listed here are also, I think, quite important and maybe interesting to many of you. So on the slide before, those were the code things that we want to do, and these are the community and infrastructure changes that are pretty much already decided. We are very happy that we have received new mirror servers from LeaseWeb, which has become our sponsor. These are the servers that serve as the entry point for all downloads of official releases and add-ons. So it's really, really quite important to us that they work and that they don't go down and have some redundancy. So we are very obliged to LeaseWeb. And this may even allow us to increase add-on auto update frequency, which at the moment was limited by our quite dated server hardware. The online translation handling, which is now done on Transifex by lots of members of the community, to who we are very grateful for, will switch to WebLite, among other things, because Transifex is a closed source and WebLite is an open source product, and we just like to work with open source, being an open source product ourselves. And they were really quite helpful. They've given us extensive support, and WebLite is also slated to become an official sponsor in the beginning of next year. So this will mean some changes for translators, but I've seen most of it, and it's really, really cool, and I think that also translators will like it. And finally, our official webpage, kodi.tv, is now using Drupal, and it will switch to Gatsby as a static file generator / CMS, which means it will become more maintainable to us in the future. This means I'm now coming to the last slide for the presentation part of this session, on which I'd like to highlight a few opportunities how you can help us make and keep Kodi great. Right now, the most important thing would be to test version 19 and give us feedback, especially if something works. But most of the time, we only hear about things that don't work. You can head to the forums for that. You can hack on Kodi, on the code. Our GitHub account is XBMC still, because we are actually in need of core developers. We have some subsystems and even entire platforms that are next to unmaintained and blocking development of other platforms at some times. So if you know any C++ at all, be sure to give our code a look. We know it can be a bit frightening at first, because Kodi is a very large piece of software that has grown historically over a long time. I think even some code of the original Xbox is still in there. But you might notice that if you start digging around our code and maybe fixing some easy issues on GitHub, that we will also come to appreciate your help and also give you some hints on how you can further develop your C++ and work with us in the future. You can also develop and submit Python add-ons for Kodi or binary add-ons. You can translate Kodi and the add-ons in the future with WebLite, as I mentioned. You can write documentation on the wiki, which is also quite important to users, that the wiki documentation is up to date. And also there, we at the moment don't have a lot of people working on that, so we are quite understaffed there. And you can also help others on the forums, which is always appreciated. Yeah, and again, last but not least, you can also give us money on LiberoPay, Patreon, PayPal, etc., or via SEPA bank transfer. And the donation money goes to the Kodi Foundation, which is the legal entity behind Kodi. We have no employees. We are all volunteers. No one is paid for any Kodi work. And the money goes to the cost of our infrastructure, of hardware costs for developers, hosting our annual developer conference, which was unfortunately not possible this year, and travel expenses to conferences. Yeah, that's what you can do. And from our side, a quick update on the situation this year. We welcomed 5 new team members who have already been very active. For example, one of them is really driving the adoption of the Gatsby site generator that I've shown you. We have moved to GitHub issues from using Flex before, which has also been a success for us. We now have a much better visibility of the issues that are being experienced at the moment. We have established a code of conduct. And we are now doing monthly team meetings, which we've actually not done before on Zoom, in a Zoom meeting. And I think pretty much all of the time, at least 20 people show up of the team and chat about our current issues. And this has also helped get the release rolling again, because our release manager that was working as release manager until V18 stepped down for V19. So it took some time until we found a replacement, which is who is Dave Blake. And this also delayed the release quite a bit. So that's it from my side for the presentation. Now we will go over to the Q&A session. Again, here is the QR code you can use to log into the session and ask questions. Or you go to pigeonhole.at and enter the passcode CodyRC3. Please be aware that only a subset of team members is now present, so we might not be able to answer all the questions in the depth that you would like. But if you write us an email to contact@cody.tv, we can also answer that question after the talk, maybe. Okay, thanks for your attention, and I will now hand over to Race, which will lead the Q&A session.
Thanks. We do already have a question. I'm not sure if it's best for you to answer it, if you can answer it. But if you don't want to answer it, I think Sabus is up for it.
Yeah, Sabus, go for it.
Hey, I'm Zarbus. I'm a bit into rendering systems and Python development in general. HDR on a Raspberry Pi is, from my understanding, an issue of the drivers. So we can't do much about it, as well as LibreELEC or OSMC. So I think the Raspberry Pi Foundation has to develop drivers which support HDR.
If I can just quickly add to that, with LibreELEC, we have a very good relationship and also have some shared team members that are working both with LibreELEC and with Kodi. So I think that would not be the blocker. So if you see HDR working on the Raspberry Pi, then it will pretty much also work in LibreELEC if it works in Kodi.
So that's it for questions, I guess. We could wait a little bit more, but as the stream is lagging a bit behind, it might be hard. So I guess that's it.